Hello, everyone, and thank you for downloading this episode of Park Views with Brad Hughes. I am your host, Brad Hughes. You can follow me on Twitter at Views with Hughes. Please rate and review the show on iTunes and Stitcher as well. And don't forget to check out the YouTube channel, youtube.com/thedailydisneyblog. And with that said, let's get on with the show. Five, four, three, two. Hello, everyone, and welcome to another episode of Park Views with Brad Hughes. I am not by myself today. Today I'm here with the lovely, the beautiful, the wonderful, the perfect, Duncan James. No, Holly Roos is here helping me out on the show today. Hello.
Hi.
How are you?
Wonderful. How are you?
This feels genuine because I really haven't seen you much today.
I know.
So it feels like actually genuine that I'm saying hi for like the first time. It kind of feels
weird.
Right. So today, pretty quick show. Nothing super crazy. Nothing too long. Not a lot of news to cover, but there is some really important news going on. And then we're going to dive into some listener questions. And that will be it for today. If you hear that noise in the background,
it is monsooning outside.
It was raining like crazy outside. We were actually not even planning on doing a show tonight. We were actually going to go try and ride Hagrid's again. And then the sky opened up and we were like, never mind.
Here we are.
So we decided to do a show tonight instead. And I think that's good because I really didn't want to do anything today anyway. So it all worked out very well. Do you have our first story up and running and ready to talk about it?
First, I want to talk about Hagrid.
Okay.
We haven't talked about this yet.
Oh, you're right. We haven't. Not on the podcast. So let's deep dive into the entire day. Go ahead and start. Set the scene for the day.
So Hagrid officially opened last Thursday, the 13th.
Yes, we got there on the Friday.
We didn't go Thursday because we both had to work. But Friday, we were able to go. And we got there. We were at the parking garage at 6:30. Walking to security. It was maybe, all the rows were full, but maybe 10 cars deep. For parking, so we're like, oh, this doesn't look so bad. So we proceed to walk through security, walk through City Walk, and we lined up at the turnstiles. Not too many people. They were trying to make announcements about what was going on. Nothing really of substance until about 7:30, give or take.
Yeah.
When they announced that Hagrid's not going to be opening with the park, and we have no idea when it's going to open, but it'll probably be around noon.
They were saying best case scenario is 11.
So imagine all of these people that have been there since 6:30 in the morning.
So you're already waiting 4.5 hours.
Correct. You were waiting 2.5 for the ride to open.
Second the place opens, not walking through all the queue.
That's 2.5 hours on 6:30 to 9. Everybody was anticipating.
Well, no, I'm saying best case scenario was 11. So best case scenario, that if you walked on the ride and got on it the second you got to the attraction, you're still waiting 5 hours.
Meanwhile, if the ride was actually up and running at open, we would have been done by 11 o'clock.
Yeah, 11:30.
And actually been able to do things around the park. But alas.
We'll get to that.
They were saying that Hagrid, because it ran late, they didn't get to complete all their maintenance and testing overnight. But that's not the guest's fault that you didn't cut off the queue early enough for it to close down for a proper amount of time.
It's also nonsense because Disney does extra magic hours till 1 a.m. sometimes. And they open at 8.
And so if the ride stayed running once it got open again, I'd be like, okay, you know, it's a new ride. They're still figuring out. But it went down at least every 30 minutes. It went down at least a dozen times when they were there. And it wasn't 14, weather.
It was 14 total. Yeah, it was not weather related. It was 14 times total it went down. I counted. Every time they made an announcement, it was 14 different times. And it was very frustrating. I wrote an article over on Theme Park Duo if you want to go read my thoughts. Here's the thing. My thoughts on the attraction are it's probably the greatest roller coaster in Orlando.
I can't wait to ride it again, but I'm not.
Nothing is worth a 9-hour wait except Rise of the Resistance for me. Like, that's the only thing I would be like, all right, we're doing this. Like, I'm not going to wait.
I wouldn't
wait 9 hours for Millennium Falcon again.
Like, I will say it was nice that they let you leave the line and get food and come back, and they gave out bottled water.
That was only when it was outside.
But also, you're now having these people stuck in line for 9 hours. Here you can go buy food. Like, I feel like at that point they should have almost handed out bags of chips or something. Don't you?
I don't know. I mean, it's your choice. I'm torn on that because it's your choice to stand in that line. You know what's happening. If you choose to stay in that line, that's kind of why I feel weird about being upset. My thing is, I'm not upset.
It's frustrating.
It's frustrating. Like, it's frustrating if you wait in line for 9 hours. Like, it just is. Especially when they don't tell you anything. Like, Disney, when the ride goes down, they don't let you stay in the queue. You know, they dump the queue and then it's like, there's no line. That's good and bad. Like, especially with this, that would have been bad. Like, having to get in and out every single time. But I don't know. I'm partially thinking, like, it's your choice to stay in that line if you choose to do so.
Yeah, and they made it as easy as they could to leave.
The ride's not ready. Like, I don't know why they're so determined on having it open. Like, it's not like they put it up against Galaxy's Edge. You know what I mean? Like, they didn't open it on August 28th and, like, trying to get a jump and, like, make it the big deal. Like, it's in the middle of before summer hits. Like, give it a few weeks. Like,
and
a week
now
or so.
Your ride's not even open a week, and Universal announced yesterday. They put out a statement that it's not going to open till at least midday every single day.
That's insane.
So don't line up. It said go enjoy the rest of the park.
If Disney did this, people would be losing their minds.
That's
the people who are like,
it's admitting defeat right there.
But it's like the people who are like, yo, you know, that's like acting like this isn't a big deal. This is a colossal disaster. Like, it just is. Like, it was also a colossal disaster when Frozen kept evacuating, having issues.
Yep.
I'm not defending Disney in certain things. Like, remember when Flight of Passage kept breaking all the time? That was a disaster too. Like, it's a disaster, whether it's Universal or Disney. It's just not good. This one seems worse because it's like they're just so nonchalant about it. Like, sorry, it's not open.
And they're blaming it on the weather. Like, I'm reading it right now and it says we've been managing through significant weather delays and running the attraction.
There's been weather, but that's not why it was down. Come on. I'll tell you the exact, like, spoiler if you don't want to know anything about Hagrid going in. The problem is the drop part.
Yep. Well, they're saying here that they're not giving their team enough time to do the daily maintenance. So shouldn't you have thought about that before? How much maintenance does this require daily? So the latest night that people were there, the team member told us they were supposed to leave at 10 and they left at 10:30. Okay, so that gives you...
I said 12:30.
It was definitely before midnight. Regardless, that's okay. So say midnight. That's still 9 hours to do maintenance on an attraction. That's brand new and shouldn't really need maintenance.
They do preventative stuff, but you're right. Like, it doesn't need 9 hours. No, they're not doing 9 hours on Space Mountain. That's been there since.
No, and the day that we were there, the reason we found out it kept stopping was because there was a ride vehicle that was giving them issues that they continued to run, and the girl was finally like, what did she say? We've been trying to run this, but now we're going to take it off. And
put two trains in its place.
We don't know how long it's going to take.
It ended up taking not that long, but it's just like, it's not a way to, like, I don't understand. Like, this is total corporate thinking. Like, they have your money. You want to ride this new thing. And here's the thing. Like, Disney would care and, like, you know, maybe give you tickets to come back another day or something. Universal does not care.
Like, don't blame it on crowds. You knew their crowds were going to be there.
The team members kept telling us when we were in line, oh, we were expecting this. I kept going, you were expecting this? Like,
right.
I expect to have issues on opening day. Yep. Not the entire day be an issue. Like, having issues on a new attraction is completely expected. Yep. However, Millennium Falcon, which is a brand new ride system, did not go down once on opening day. So, like...
Yeah. Well, the point that broke us in line was
fair,
about...
Rise of the Resistance isn't open yet, but...
About 7 hours into the line, planned. Would you say, that we got to that one room? So we got inside the building and we were like, yes, air conditioning. We can hold out for 2 more hours. Mm-hmm. And then you go after the pre-show into this greenhouse room.
The pre-show's mediocre at best, by the way.
And my God, that room was sweltering. It felt like they put you in a sauna.
That's the room that Sam from Expedition Theme Park was stuck in forever.
I don't know how people weren't passing out
in
there.
Yeah, I don't know. Because
you're
no
inside
way to get water,
with no ventilation, and no air conditioning.
It was brutal. It was like being outside.
And that's where we were like, all right, off to the single rider line.
We walked in. We were there for about 3 minutes, and I was like, nope. Because I had to go. I potentially had to go to work that day. I ended up not having to go. But
you already have been sweating outside for...
Oh, God. Was insane.
One good thing, though, I discovered that Universal has a fantastic gyro.
Yeah, they do.
Which we don't really eat quick service at the parks.
I can't tell you the last time I ate quick service at Universal.
Yeah, because we're never really there that long. And if we do, we want to try CityWalk restaurants. We love Anahitos.
Oh, my God. Anahitos is great.
But yeah, we got a gyro and buffalo chicken fingers from the place on the Lost Continent. And that gyro was so good.
No, that's it. My mom got the hot dog.
You had a butter beer, and then I had one of those Long Island iced teas.
We had enough time to go stand by before we even got into the attraction and ride Forbidden Journey, me and my mother.
Yep.
That's crazy.
They did have characters like coming through the line to greet people, and they were trying to make it fun, but how fun can 95 degrees?
I give them props for trying.
We lucked out because we were in the shade, but there was people waiting like in the sun.
I don't know how he stayed.
No.
Poor guy. I love him.
He's my brother. And stayed in that greenhouse room.
Yeah, that's crazy to me.
But I mean, thunderstorms or not, if this was the winter and we weren't having this rain, they would have had the same issues.
Yeah, don't blame it on the rain. You say it's not up to our standard. Like Disney said with Rise of the Resistance, it's not up to our standards. We're not opening it till it is. That's
how you should do it.
That's how you should do it. Like that statement should have said, we appreciate all the enthusiasm for Hagrid's. We want to give you the experience that you deserve. In honor of that, we're going to be closing for 2 days, 3 days to get this thing up and running the way it should be. I get it. They have people who are coming opening week.
But it's not like they had merchandise with dates on it, like nothing.
But that's the problem. People book for this. Like people book trips for this.
What happens when you announce a hard date like that and you don't give yourself any wiggle room? I think that was a race to the finish line to even get that ready for the media night. Had to be.
I didn't hear anything about it breaking down during the meet, unless they just were like, don't cover it. If you do, you're not invited back.
Well, we rode the ride twice because
you know, Sean about that. See if he was
the
there.
The first time it broke down on us and we were stuck in the pouring rain for a solid 7 to 8 minutes. We were just left out on the track. No announcements or anything.
Yeah.
Which is frustrating. There's about to be a thunderstorm rolling through and you're just like, da-da-da.
Well, that wasn't the worst part for us getting stuck there. The creepiest part.
Well, then we were offered a re-ride, which was not helping the standby line because everybody was getting a dang re-ride because the ride couldn't run
Everyone
flawlessly.
Who got off that ride pretty much got re-ride because it was
We could have ridden it five times if we wanted to, but it didn't run smoothly at all that day. And the second time we rode it was
the
most...
I give them props for the re-ride, though.
Yes.
It hurts and helps.
Absolutely. You want the re-ride if you didn't have... But the scariest time, the second time you and I got to ride together because it was a re-ride. And
did we bailed when single rider? I know we said we bailed. Yes. We did single rider.
So we got stuck in... If you don't want to know about the ride, don't listen.
Yep.
But there's a part where you drop 16 and a half feet. You go into this dark forest, which is in a show building. It's not outside. And you drop 16 and a half feet. And then it's just open air above you. Like into the show building, and then you shoot out, and that's the finale to the ride. We got stuck after the drop, just sitting there. We probably sat there for 10 minutes.
It was 15.
Yeah. And then all of a sudden, we're sitting there, the ride's not moving, and all of a sudden, you hear guests screaming and the roller coaster going, and we're like, holy crap, is this thing about to
roll on top of us? Because we're lowered into the thing.
Yep. And granted, of course,
that was such a scary moment.
Safety, but
we know they have safe, but the ride's not working.
Why is one piece going and another's not going? That was terrifying.
Especially, we should be going before the end,
right?
Because that part has to lift back up, and but
that coaster, it's beautiful. And
God, that ride is amazing.
The last part, you actually feel like you're in a forest.
Yeah, the ride is a 10 out of 10.
Incredible.
It is hands down the best attraction at Universal. It's the best coaster by far in Orlando.
Just get it together.
I still think Everest might be a little bit better.
I only got to ride sidecar. You got to ride the motorcycle the whole time.
Because I couldn't fit into the sidecar. Like, my legs don't fit. As it were, my feet didn't fit in the spot they give you. I had to, like, turn my feet to the side.
Sidecar's a little more restrictive, they said, and not as tall people friendly.
This ride's not tall people. Wesley will not be able to fit on this ride.
No. You barely fit.
I barely fit, and I'm 6'3".
Yep.
And they're like, I was like, am I too fat for this ride? And they're like, no. It's your leg. There's no room for your legs. Yep. It's very strange. So that's our, I guess, review of Hagrid's.
Yep. I was just reading what people were responding to their press statement.
Yeah, their press statement's bullcrap, honestly. Yeah. Unfortunately, it's not reality.
But
all right, what is our next story here? Give me something fun and positive we can talk about.
Annual pass holders can now bring a friend to the parks for a discounted price.
That's exciting. Do they have dates for that?
I think it started.
With what we're going to talk about later, they better.
Yeah. So this is each pass holder, so you and I, could each buy up to 6 tickets. You have to use a day of.
This is
$89. Yeah, $89 plus tax
one park, day, one park.
For a park hopper.
What?
Mm-hmm.
Wow.
Yep, and they can upgrade that as well.
Interesting. They can upgrade that to a
starting discounted today through August 8th.
Interesting.
So very cool.
Not a bad idea. And
kind of staying on the pass holders, Disney Parks blog announced a whole slew of perks. Meanwhile, it's really kind of things like free parking thing. they were trying to soften the blow of what happened today, which we'll get there.
This is like damage control, huh?
This was yesterday.
Oh, they knew.
Yeah, so yesterday they announced that Bring a Friend deal, a discount on H2O Glow, a discount on Villains After Hours, which is apparently not doing so well.
Yeah, they did cast member dates for that, so.
Yeah, and then here comes the fun one. They announced they're excited to share that annual pass holders will be the first to experience Galaxy's Edge, caveat, Platinum, Platinum Plus, and Premier. So if you're gold, silver, you're blocked out, but gold, you're shafted on this one. That's the first one they have.
Here's the reason, though. Like, not defending just it.
So many pass holders.
Exactly. Especially gold. Mm-hmm. Like, I used to work in ticketing. I
used to do gold for how many years?
Yeah. That is probably out of the 100% pie of Florida resident, especially Central Florida residents.
60, 65.
I would say 75% of people are silver or gold. Most people aren't platinum, platinum
plus.
Glad
we went platinum plus.
Yep. I had a feeling this was going to happen because of the Toy Story Land thing.
Yep.
And I was like, when we do our annual passes, we need to get the highest one because that way we know anything they do other than Premier.
But don't worry, you still get 20% off merchandise and select table service dining and complimentary standard parking.
Don't worry, you get the things we told you you had already.
Yep. Oh, this was actually really cool. And if we didn't have Platinum Plus, I would say we would do this. So they're they're doing something called Summer Splash Pass.
It just turned off.
So beginning July 5th, pass holders will be able to purchase a new Summer Splash Pass to receive unlimited visits to Blizzard Beach and Typhoon Lagoon from July 5th to September 7th for the same cost as a non-discounted one-day ticket. So essentially, you're getting to add the water park portion of the pass for the summer for just $69. So that's a pretty good deal.
That's pretty cool.
So yeah, that tells me that the water parks aren't doing too.
That's not surprising, I don't think.
We've gone on Saturdays and it's not busy. We love the water parks.
People don't know about them.
Yep.
I think, honestly, that the water park should be included in all annual passes just to get people to go.
Yep. So also in line with annual passes, what happened today after everybody yesterday was like, I'm going to upgrade.
Before we talk about that, I want to talk about what shirt you're wearing.
What shirt am I wearing?
What shirt are you wearing? You tell me.
Yesterday, we were at Epcot bright and early at open because the...
We were one of eight people.
Okay, no, there was a crazy pin line, but we're not pin people because that's a rabbit hole we don't need to go into.
I just don't care about them.
No, and I bought the
Darkwing Duck pin because it had Negaduck on it.
Yeah.
And the Father's Day one because it was a Goofy movie, but...
So this was the Farewell Illuminations t-shirt.
I love it. It is super cute. The only complaint I have is it's Mickey on a black shirt. And so his body looks
like floating
in with it. So like you don't see his ears really unless you're in the sunlight or like in direct light. And it looks like he has like decapitated head and arms and body and torso. You're not there. But it's him blowing out the illuminations, reflections of Earth, torch. And
they had some really cute tumblers.
Missed opportunity if Jim Cummings doesn't come and do the last one in person.
He tweeted something about it today, I saw.
He did?
Yeah.
What did he say?
But just saying that it's sad that he's been the host for 20 years and it's coming to a close.
Oh, I bet you money. We need to get him back on the show before this. Mm-hmm. That'd be fun.
So today, they also announced parking fees at the resorts increased.
Oh, I saw this.
So they are just kind of, it's subtle. It's a couple dollars here and there, but still. Oy.
If you're an annual pass holder or somebody who has a 14-day ultimate ticket or cast member, you don't pay the overnight resort fee.
Yep.
So if you're any of those things, you're omit from that. That's always been the case, but just there's a lot of miscommunication about that.
So keeping in the annual pass realm, and then I have something else I want to talk about that I don't know if you saw it today. So these annual passes. So yesterday they announced, okay, Platinum, Platinum Plus, Premier, come on in, Galaxy's Edge previews. You'll get your sign up soon. Everybody else, meh. So if you want to upgrade, don't worry. The Platinum Pass only went up about $150 overnight. So now you're having to pay the difference between the gold that you paid before prices to this new platinum price. Like that. Some of these out-of-state passes are over. The out-of-state platinum plus is $1,219. When I worked in guest relations, $1,200 was the premier passport. And now that's over $2,000.
Yeah. It's crazy. What? It's crazy. However.
They need to do it. It's
Two things. First off, $1,200 for a year of Galaxy's Edge is not that much money.
And we're going to see little increases for the next few years now because they did this.
Is the big one. This is like the Disneyland. I have been saying for a while this one was coming. I thought it would be before
that's
this.
That's why we bought our passes.
We bought our passes back in February. Yeah. The Platinum Pluses. You upgraded and I bought a brand new Platinum Plus pass because I knew this was coming.
Yep, it was renewal time.
And I don't know. I'm of two minds. I said this on Twitter today. If you're complaining about the annual price increases and you still buy one,
nobody's making you buy it.
Yeah, you know, if you don't, God, I'm gonna sound like a dick. If you can't afford it, I'm sorry.
That's the thing. If
I'm not, but I don't mean it in a condescending like you're poor way. Like it sucks that you can't afford what you used to be able to afford. But that's the way it goes. And if you're complaining about these prices and you still buy one, I don't want to hear you complaining because the companies do not give a crap if you're complaining about something. All they care about is the money that you give them. If you give them money for this, then you are validating that that's worth that to you. And if it's worth it to you, I don't want to hear it because I don't care. Like if it's worth it to you to buy it, then it's worth it to you for you to buy it.
And I was talking with one of my friends today and she made a good point that this is only a, if you calculate it out, it's 27 cents a day it's gone up.
Yeah, but you have to pay all that in one time. Like
out of state, yeah, but Florida residents, I mean, just put when I upgraded from gold to platinum plus, I just put more money down and it kept my payments the same. So if you want
it. It's a little easier to
don't go
it
get
for
the
Florida
$6
residents.
Coffee at Starbucks. Stop eating out every night. Like if you really want a Disney pass that bad, you make it up.
It's a little easier for Florida residents because you can do that monthly payment plan. For Florida, non-Florida residents, they have to pay that outright. That's insane.
That's outrageous.
But again, you get a year of, think about a year of Magic Kingdom, a year.
How much is a one-day park hopper? Is almost 200 now, right? It's like 180.
It depends on the day. It's state-based now, so it depends.
So it could be like 180 though.
It could be, I think, 190.
So you're paying
one-day park hopper.
So 6-day park hopper. I know it gets cheaper as you add days.
Not much anymore.
But in theory, that's paid for an annual pass. So if you're coming more than...
If you come 14 days in a year, it's still worth your money to buy an annual pass. So it just... It sucks that it's more expensive. 100%. I get it. But if you're complaining about it and you're on Twitter yelling about... And you know what's so funny? I haven't gotten a single comment back on that statement because they know I'm right.
That's the thing.
I get
like
hate on everything I say lately. It's just like... You know what I mean? Like people go and being snarky and it's like, you can't be snarky. It's a fact. Companies don't care if you're upset about it. They just care if you pay for it. But here's the thing too. Like Galaxy's Edge is an expensive billion dollar expansion. Mm-hmm. Like they have to pay for that money somehow. And I know it's Disney and I know they make a ton
of money.
They're
going to make it hand over fist in merchandise.
Yes. But like it's a business. Disney is a business. It sucks to say, but it is
an attempt at crowd control.
It's an attempt at crowd control for sure. But I think it's more of a, I mean, think about all the stuff they have going on right now that is construction projects, and they're expensive, and there's a budget for stuff. I mean, it is a corporation.
Do you think we'll see a multi-day?
Which is exactly why Hagrid is still up and running, because it's a corporation. They have to pay.
Do you think we'll see a multi-day ticket increase again before it opens?
Don't they usually do one in August anyway?
Yeah. So then, because the one, when they did the multi-day one was usually when they do the pass one, the pass holder one. Just curious.
It sucks. And I'm not trying to sound elitist because I don't make a crap ton of money. We're not rich beyond belief. We are fine.
We save money too.
But we allot stuff. You know, it's what's it worth to you? If it's worth it to you to have it,
what
then I don't want to hear you complain about it.
Exactly.
If you're not doing it anymore, then you're not doing it anymore. And Disney will notice that. And if enough people don't do this, you will see prices go down. The only reason prices are continuing to increase is because people are at the parks. Even with all these price increases, the parks are still freaking mad crazy, and it's not going to change unless people stop coming. So if you stop coming, prices will go down. It's supply and demand.
Do you feel like we've noticed a drop off the past couple weeks?
Because people are waiting for Galaxy's Edge. We're this close out.
We've been going a lot because it's been hot, but it hasn't been sweltering hot for summer.
I always so we're say trying I can to do hot and crowded, hot or crowded. I can't do both.
So we've been trying to take advantage of that. But
I feel bad for people who aren't going to be able to go buy annual passes. But here's the thing. If you come and use your annual pass for 8 days out of the year, you're not really getting your money out of annual pass anyway.
Right.
And it might make more sense at this point just to buy tickets. And then if that's the case, then what's the difference?
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like us, it would make zero sense for us not to have annual passes. But
we live down
if you
the
live
street.
In Washington State and you come 14 times a year, 2 7-day tickets might be cheaper at this point.
And we kind of rotate what we have. Like we took a year off Universal. We're taking a year off
SeaWorld. We have
SeaWorld
and Universal right now. We have everything right now.
We're about to take a year off SeaWorld because we don't go.
I want to go to see Sesame Street and then I'm canceling our passes because...
Go during Electric Ocean. And
yeah, maybe see who's coming, if Lifehouse is coming again soon. God, I love them.
But Universal, this was a point people were making. Universal, no blockout dates. It's like $400 for a year.
But it's Universal.
But it's also two parks.
It's much smaller, not as good.
Completely different.
It's not as...
So yes, it's a great deal if your kids are that age.
I don't care about most... I don't think... Okay, so Harry Potter, I don't necessarily care about. Like, if they go, we're demolishing Harry Potter, I wouldn't be like, no. Fast and the Furious, Jurassic Park, Marvel, but... It's not really Marvel. I mean, come on. It's cardboard cutouts from the 90s. Over on the other side, you have Fast and the Furious, Despicable Me, Men in Black.
We like Universal, though. Don't act like we don't like it.
I'm not. No. That's not what I'm saying. I'm saying none of those IPs I care about. The Simpsons was probably the closest one that I care about to Disney.
And they're
Disney now. And for sure, Fast and the Furious.
You feel me?
And they're Disney now. So, like, I don't know. It's just, it's too, to me, they're two different things.
Mm-hmm.
Like, Disney is Disney. You get Epcot. Are we really going to consider and compare, like, IOA and Universal versus the other the Disney parks? Like, my least favorite park is probably Epcot right now, which used to be probably my number one, but it's my least favorite right now. Epcot is still a hands and feet above everything that exists at either Universal or Islands of Adventure or Volcano Bay.
Yeah.
It just is. Like,
we love Volcano Bay, but when it comes to a water park
I would rather
day,
go to Blizzard Beach.
Yeah, because we're like, do we want to ride a bus? Or do we want to...
I just like Blizzard Beach better.
Yeah.
Like I said on Twitter today, I'm a Disney fanboy. I am. It just is what it
100%.
Is. It doesn't mean I don't like Universal. If I didn't like it, I wouldn't have an annual pass to it.
Correct.
But I don't know. I just find it funny how people defend certain things. And then I'm pretty biased, I think.
Yep.
Unbiased?
If that's an argument that Universal's $400 a year, okay, well, look at SeaWorld. You can go for $8 a month.
Yeah. And you get
is it the same thing?
Exactly. It's not. Don't pretend it is.
No.
You can like Universal, but it's not Disney World. No. It's just not.
Maybe if you have teenage boys, they probably are going to prefer Universal. And your family might find more value in that, but it's different for everyone.
It is. It's different for everybody. So just do what you want to do and shut the fuck up if these prices increases offend you. Sorry, I should have said that.
Speaking of ways for them to make more money, have you seen the new... Do you remember during the Christmas party how they did like the come and go as you want in Tony's Town Square? Mm-hmm. Forget what it was called.
Yeah,
they're doing
Tony's
one,
something festive.
They're doing one for
something.
The Halloween party.
Oh.
And I kind of want to do this.
Okay.
So it's called Cruella's Halloween Hideaway.
Nice.
Which is a cute idea, right? So part of Not So Scary, it's $99 a person. In addition to park tickets, but it's going to be beer, wine, sangria, and snacks. I mean, look at that picture. It's a charcuterie board, which
please tell me why they don't do this at Hollywood Studios where you can have hard liquor.
Why won't they do hard liquor at Kingdom? Because
they don't do booze at Magic Kingdom. It's barely wine.
Do they not have the license in the park?
I think it's Disney. If they want to license the park, they can have it. It's not about that. They have it everywhere else on property. It's just they try to keep Magic Kingdom and Disneyland the same way.
This sounds really good. I mean, they're going to have spinach dip, Halloween flatbreads, cannolis, cheesecakes, Rice Krispies, mini DeVille brownies. It sounds cute. And they have a reserved viewing area for the parade. And you can meet Cruella and some of her pals.
God, taking a week off drinking has really made me a lightweight. This one drink, I'm like, whoa.
So... But yeah, I like that these parties are not here's an hour, have fun. This is like come and go as you want. You want to come back for a snack and
I
have
love
dessert
that
later.
Idea.
I think we were this
That's
will
what
be something.
Sucks about fireworks dessert parties is you feel like you have to rush and like eat as much as you can. This you can go all the whole night, but the only problem is it's also in one fixed location. So
at
if
the
you're
very front of the park.
If you're at, you know, Splash Mountain, you're like, I want to go get
a
beer.
I think this will be something we do, though.
Oh, 100%. I definitely will do this and do a video on it. So. By the way, speaking of videos, thank you, everyone, for watching this and listening to this, for going to YouTube and subscribing to the YouTube channel. We hit 1,000.
We're official now.
Followers. We are official YouTubers now. We're going to get that number up. We are rocking and rolling with content. If you need good Disney content,
if you have any ideas.
Ideas. Send ideas if you want. But I have a few ideas for new videos, and I really like this one we're working on. It's going to be good.
Yes.
Go to youtube.com/thedailydisneyblog. That will be changing very soon, but as of right this second, youtube.com/thedailydisneyblog. And subscribe if you haven't already, and go check out some really good videos. I would put our videos up against anyone's. The vlogs we do are really, really good, so make sure you go check that out. All right, what else you got news-wise?
That's it.
That's it?
That's all I got.
Do you want to grab some listener questions? I'll do some listener questions now.
Sure.
Let's do this. Let me make sure if I don't have any new ones, and then I can go right to where. Holly, where can they find you online while we're in the middle of this like commercial break kind of thing?
You can find me on Twitter and Instagram, Hollywood with 3Ls13.
Nice.
Where can they find you?
On Twitter at Views with Hughes. Views with Hughes on Twitter. Okay. No new ones. It's not as catchy. Yours or mine? I was going to say mine's not as catchy as yours.
I say if we ever get married, I could be Holly Hughes.
Holly Hughes, which sounds like...
Sounds like not appropriate.
By the way, McDonald's is doing a $0 delivery fee until June 23rd when you order McDonald's delivery with Uber Eats. Sponsored by McDonald's.
Someone has not shut up about a Big Mac the past week.
God, I really want one.
I'm not a huge McDonald's fan. Yeah, I'm not a fast food fan.
You're out of your mind. All right. This question comes from Steven Irizarry. I hope I said your name wrong. I hope I said your name right. If I didn't, I'm sorry. Question one, if we somehow get a Force ghost of Anakin in episode 9, do you think he'll be speaking to Ben, Rey, Luke, or Palpatine? So I'm going to assume that we are, because here's the thing. I don't think we're going to get a Force ghost of Anakin in episode 9. Think, you know, with going in all in with Emperor Palpatine, I think that's enough. I don't think you need to.
Why do you think the rumors circulating about Hayden then?
That happened with Last Jedi too.
Really?
Yeah. He started showing up at conventions again and people were like, oh my God, maybe he's going to be in episode 8.
You are all Galaxy's Edged out right
now. I know.
Now.
I did that on purpose.
Fanboy.
Hat and shirt.
I'm a shill. This is my Father's Day present.
Sorry, distracted.
It's my Father's Day present. My beautiful children. So let's assume he is in episode 9. Do I think he'll be speaking to Ben, Rey, Luke, or Palpatine? Okay, so we are under the assumption that Anakin, once he changed, well, not the assumption, but we saw in episode 6 in Return of the Jedi that he becomes a Force ghost and shows up next to Obi-Wan and Yoda, you know, on Endor, and Luke sees it, right? So as of right this moment in canon, at least unless it is set in Alphabet Squadron or a book I haven't read yet that hasn't come out yet. But as of right this second, Force Ghost is only a thing for the Jedi, not the Sith. So it can't be Palpatine because he's Sith for sure. Ben, we don't know if he's Sith or if he's just some sort of dark Force user. So I would say probably not Ben either. If he is going to show up to anybody, it would make the most sense to me that it's Luke. Rey, who doesn't know who Anakin is necessarily. It'd be interesting if it was Rey, but I think it would be a really cool moment to have Hayden Christensen be a Force ghost talking to Luke, his son, who is now also a Force ghost. I think that'd be the smart way to go with it. So out of those choices, I would say Luke would be the one that it would be.
That is all you.
Two, Disney is keeping Dominic Monaghan and Matt Smith's role very secret. What roles do you think they'll play in episode 9? First off, I'm pretty sure Dominic Monaghan is going to be one of the Knights of Ren. And Matt Smith keeps saying that he's not in the film. So if he's not in the film, he's not playing any role in the film. I just turned off. If he's not in the movie, he's not in the movie. So I don't know. If he's not, or if he's lying and he is in the film, I would say he's probably either a Knight of Ren, a new Sith Lord that we haven't seen yet, or young, or like the stand-in actor for Palpatine, maybe. I don't know. I would say probably Knight of Ren. That would be my favorite pick there. All right, next one. This is from Kate at Imaginate Kate. Favorite food at Galaxy's Edge? 100% the Ronto wrap. It was absolutely fantastic. There is nothing I've talked about more from Galaxy's Edge probably about to Holly than that Ronto wrap. And I know you're going to love it because it's a gyro with a hot dog in it. And there's nothing not to love. And what do I think Disney will do with A Journey to Imagination with all the expansions going on? What do you think?
Journey to Imagination?
What do you think they'll do to the Journey to Imagination Pavilion with all the expansion going on?
I think it's strange they haven't said anything about it. So I think it'll be left alone.
You think it'll be left alone? I think they're going to do something big.
Like that?
I think it'll be once Guardians opens and that whole left side of the park is redone. So you have the Space Restaurant.
Which is opening track, this Mission year, Space Restaurant.
I still didn't even see it.
Yeah, we went
and rode Mission Space the other day, and I still didn't even see it.
Well, to be fair, it was pouring, and we had a child pee ourselves. I know, but, so we were running to the store.
Did you even notice it?
No, but I honestly wasn't. I wasn't looking for it.
I was like looking in that direction.
Is it meant to be hidden in the? I don't know. In the bushes.
I don't know. I'm sure you'll see it when they want you to see it.
Yeah.
But it was just very strange. I think once that left side gets open and Guardians is there. And, you know, the seas is not closing, so everyone needs to stop panicking. I mean, it might.
And it is.
Who
official.
It wouldn't blow me away if they did that, but I also would be very surprised at the same time. That just seems like a really big undertaking to make sure all those animals have a safe place to go, to demolish all that. It just seems like a big undertaking.
Then go to SeaWorld.
Yeah, then I can get beaten.
Damn. We like SeaWorld.
Yeah, do we? When was that time we went? When was the last time we went to SeaWorld?
I wanted to go tonight. They closed at 8. That's late for SeaWorld.
We still have time. It's only 7. Oh, wait. No, that's a screenshot. Never mind.
7?
Screenshot.
It's like 9 o'clock.
It's a screenshot of the photo. It says 64. I
forgot it was a screenshot. And it's also monsooning outside.
Is it still raining? No, calm down. We could go ride Hagrid.
He closed at 10. I guarantee it's closed.
You think it's closed? I bet it's
Let's
not.
Let's see.
Okay. I think that they will probably retheme it and maybe do an inside-out attraction.
I want them to do that.
I just don't think they have the balls to get rid of Figment.
Is that capacity, Hagrid?
Is it?
So he opened at 2, and is that capacity? Must be nice.
I don't think they have the balls to get rid of Figment because he's on so much merchandise.
That's what I'm saying. They're not going to... He's such a big part of Epcot.
But he's in the movie Inside Out, though.
There's a Figment picture. Oh, yeah, briefly. Yep. I do remember that.
So they could put him in there with it.
Yeah.
And it would fit. I don't know. We will wait and see at D23 what Bob Chapek announced. I don't think this expansion of Epcot is going to be as big as everyone thinks it's going to be. You're going to get Ratatouille, you're going to get Guardians, and I bet you money that's it. It's just going to be like, we're putting in some green areas and some sun panels. I bet you it's
more
of that kind
of stuff. But I'm okay with
that. Yeah, but I think people are expecting way more than they're going to get out of this.
Yeah. That is fair.
This one you will like. You ready?
I'm ready.
This is from Sydney DeLorean at Sydney DeLorean. Will there ever be more Muppets in the parks?
Oh, I hope so. We're both big Muppet fans.
Love the Muppets.
That I would think make they me would, happy. But where would they expand them?
I think they could add another historical show to the Great Moments of History.
I always forget about that. I just saw that for the first time recently.
It's so good.
It's
so cute. They did such a good job. That's the right way to use Muppets in the parks.
I love Kermit. He's
the best. Hi ho, Kermit the Frog here, and we're going to learn about American history. All right.
We watched a really interesting video of a Jim Henson exhibit the other night, which Defunctland, I can't wait for that series to finish.
Speaking of
because
great
those are
Muppets.
Fantastic.
Holy crap, that dude needs Kevin. He will be here on Thursday.
He's so talented.
God, he's the best. He'll be here on Thursday.
We've seen all of those videos. But the Jim Henson exhibit had the original Kermit. And that would just be so cool to see that in person.
God, could you imagine?
And they had the...
Do you do a podcast with Kevin when he's here on Thursday?
Sure. What's the one that... The Dark Crystal? They had the original puppet from that.
I love
that
the Dark Crystal.
If that exhibit ever comes around to wherever you're listening from, you need to go see it. Because even the video got me excited for it.
God, it's cool. It's from a few years ago, too.
And the little tiny Fraggle Rock puppets.
Yes.
Those were
the dozers.
So cute.
Yeah, they're adorable. I don't know. I really wish they would just go all in because it's like they just seem so gun shy with anything new that isn't a successful franchise.
Yeah.
Which if you ran a business, you would be the same exact way. If you had a movie like Frozen that literally took the world by storm and
you're going to milk it for all it's worth.
100%. And anyone would. It's all these people who are like, I don't understand. Okay. Then you don't know business then. Because so many people, I personally think Frozen is the reason the parks are as crowded as they are. It had a renewed interest in Disney. I really do. I think that movie being so big, spawned other like other kids to go watch Tangled that maybe have not seen it before because their friends watched Frozen. It was like it was a phenomenon.
Yeah.
It's the first. I double checked this while I'm saying this. Look this up. I'm pretty sure that Frozen was the first animated feature to hit $1 billion.
Really?
Look that up.
Let's see.
The only thing I can think of that might be it is Toy Story 3, and I'm pretty sure that it didn't hit $1 billion. It was very close, like 800 and something million.
Wow. But I'm pretty sure. Do you think Toy Story 4 will break it?
100%, especially with all the good word of mouth that this movie's getting. No. Break Frozen? I don't think so.
Shrek is it number one?
Was it the first Disney film, animated film to hit $1 billion? Maybe that's what it was.
Why do you think we're having a villains party after they saw how successful it was at Hollywood Studios and how people freaked out they could meet Constantine and Hades? Why do you think we're having a party at Magic Kingdom with no villains?
I think they had, because I remember that backlash on the internet and on podcasts and people just being like, it was angry. I think they probably just don't want that level of backlash again for something. I get their stance on it, kind of like.
So why not? I
get people's upset about it. But like, again, you chose to stay in that line. That's how you chose to spend that time.
Right.
That's on you. Like however, it was also a villains event that was like, come meet these villains. And you can only meet one or two of them your entire time you're
like
there.
Like when we did May the 4th, they were like, all right, you can wait an hour to meet the Ewoks or 20 minutes to meet Rey. We're like, all right, well, Ewoks, next time.
Yeah. Let's or like, Rey. Just not do that and just go see them. Like, right. But I'm not a person who likes to meet characters in the first place. So it doesn't really bother me that I didn't have that opportunity.
Really.
People like to do that though. So I get it. But I think they're just being like, okay, let's just not go there.
Yeah.
It would make sense.
That's fair.
All right. The next question comes from Rodrigo Tarubia at Shinjirod. S-H-I-N-J-I-R-O-D.
Frozen is the highest grossing animated film of all time. $1,274,219,009.
Thought so. So that is number one?
Yep. Incredibles 2 is right behind it. Yep. With.
But it was also the first one to make $1 billion, right? First animated. Type in first animated feature to make $1 billion. This question comes from Rodrigo. It says, if you could make your own Star Wars colored milk, what color would it be and what would it taste like?
Purple.
You do purple milk? You go first.
I don't know.
I have my answer. It's stupid.
I have to think
easy.
About this. What is it?
Yellow milk.
Why
banana
yellow?
Flavored.
Oh, well, yeah.
Come on.
Anything banana.
Come on. What's the deal with yellow milk?
I don't need flavored milk.
I like it. Ugh. I like it. It's yummy.
I'm not one to drink milk unless I'm having cereal or an Oreo. So
I don't just go chug milk either, but no. I like banana milk. Nesquik used to make banana milk.
I know.
It was
you told
freaking
me that.
Delicious. Let me just double check. Make sure we don't have any more. And that's it. All right. That is our show for today. Thank you so much for downloading this episode. We will see you guys next time. You can follow me on Twitter at Views with Hughes. You can see me yelling at people on the internet and being silly. Holly, they can find Holly over at Hollywood 13. That's with 3 L's. Makes a lot of sense. No, it doesn't.
It was taken with 2 L's, so shush.
And then YouTube.
God's punishing you immediately.
YouTube.com/TheDailyDisneyBlog. And that is it. We will see you guys next time. Till the spire.
Oh, Lord.
Well, I hope you enjoyed this episode of Park Views with Brad Hughes. Thank you for downloading. I will see you guys next time. But before we leave, don't forget, follow me on Twitter and Periscope and Instagram at Views with Hughes. And rate and review the show on iTunes and Stitcher. I'll see you guys next time. Have a great day.